Okay, if I could encourage members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible. The final item of business this evening is a member's business debate on motion 12524. In the name of Claire Adamson, on No Falls Week 2024, the debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons, and I invite Claire Adamson to open the debate around 7 minutes. Ms Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It is a privilege to open this debate to mark the inaugural No Falls Week in our National Parliament. Thank you to my MSP colleagues who supported the motion and for those who are speaking this evening. And also, thank you to the campaigners of the No Falls Foundation, the trade unions, the safety advocates, Scottish Hazards, and all those pushing for this vital issue to be addressed. No Falls Week falls from the 13th to the 17th of May. I also give a special mention to Peter Bennett, Chair of Access Industry Forum and Chair of the Board of Trustees of No Falls Foundation, for his work. Peter gave a presentation on falls from height at our cross-party group on accident prevention and safety awareness, and it was this presentation that drove home to me the severity of the issue and prompted me to seek this debate. The No Falls Foundation charity are coordinating the first No Falls Week and have produced a toolkit with resources and guidelines to assist organisations in planning and implementing activities during No Falls Week to promote safe working at height all year round. Meanwhile, Access Industry Forum represents the 10 leading trade associations and federations involved in working at height. Between them, they train more than 300,000 people every year to work safely at height. And it is estimated over 1 million businesses and 10 million workers carry out work involving some form of working at height every year. That gives a picture of the scale of the issue and emphasises the potential for injury or death with that many people are exposed to while they work. When you delve into the figures behind the campaign, and then more importantly, the people behind those figures, it becomes clear why it is needed. The latest figures from the Health and Safety Executive show that 40 people lost their lives due to a fall from height in the UK last year, 2022, to 23. Falls from height were responsible for a staggering 30% of all workplace deaths. And every year, thousands of non-fatal falls take place, estimated to be as many as 100 every day. There's considerable underreporting of workplace injuries, particularly from self-employed people. And bluntly, the data that we have doesn't reveal the full picture. Improving these outcomes will require collaboration across the UK, as some of the policy areas are reserved. But in general, accurate data collection across safety policy remains a crucial problem. The AIF has renewed its call for a new simplified system of reporting to accurately reflect the cause of workplace accidents. We hear the same call from an array of safety organisations. Clear and accurate reporting is necessary for informed preventative measures to address the cause of accidents. Data is severely limited on the circumstances surrounding falls, limited on the common cause of falls from height. We have poor data on whether falls from an existing permanent structure or a temporary equipment, whether falls are from equipment not designed for working at height, and we don't know how many of those injured or killed were formally trained. Despite the huge, immense economic and human cost of accidents, the pressure that accidents put on the frontline health services and the tragic impact on people and their families, we still have problems in reporting, which makes preventative action even more difficult. Is this lack of training, negligence, faulty equipment? We can't answer these questions without more robust data collection. We have an idea of the economic cost of inaction, but we can't calculate the cost to those people who have lost a loved one. Working at height always has inherent dangers. And we were told at the CPG of falls of only 2 inches from trips on different levels leading to serious, serious injury. Hundreds of thousands of incidents every year are avoidable, and safety organisations' research has long shown that. And we cannot allow an approach to safety policy that is not responding to the information that we have and looking to improve the situation regarding falls from height in the future. Presiding Officer, we must redouble our efforts in data collection, training, standards and working with trade unions and employers to ensure people working at height are adequately equipped. If you have fragmented accident data, you will get fragmented policy action. Simpler and easier reporting would ensure that regulators can focus their intervention on training and prevention. Collaboration between government, employers and workers is a must, and trade unions have played a vital role in raising awareness amongst workers and empower people to speak up on safety in their workplace. And I commend also the work of Scottish Hazards. The HSE will remain a pivotal stakeholder in this. And trading standards are a crucial tool in ensuring suppliers fulfil their duty of care to make products which are safe and fit for purpose. New technology will also play a role. We have modern construction techniques, innovations in safety and wearable technologies. New wonders like cobots then significantly reduce or eliminated the risks of working at height. And I was delighted to attend New College Lanarkshire in my constituency at their Motherwell campus and see cobots being used to repair wind turbines, work that would normally have been taken place by people abseiling onto the equipment, one of the most dangerous things that can be done in our renewable energies. So we must embrace these and also use drones to look at the monitoring of buildings and of our bridges. And as someone who took part in the Fourth Road Bridge inquiry in the committee in this parliament, I know how important the safety aspects of the reviews of the bridges being, and that can happen safely and more regularly with the use of drone technology. A fall from height can be life-changing. Many people do not return to their job after an incident, and it has serious consequences for that person and their family and colleagues. So thank you again to everyone who has taken part in the debate today. And again, in Peter Bennett's sobering presentation to CPG, what stood out for me was not the figures that we do know, but mainly the figures that we don't know and should know to make it safe for people and ensure people come home from their work at the end of the day. So thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms Adamson. We move to the open debate. I call first Tim Eagle to be followed by Christine Graham. Mr Eagle, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you. Can I thank the member, Claire Adamson, for bringing this to the Chamber? It's a very important debate, actually, and one that we definitely want to be talking about to reduce deaths on industries throughout Scotland. It's so easy done, though, Presiding Officer. Perhaps there has been a storm a few days ago. The shed roof has been damaged, a roof tile out of place, a bit of painting needing done just out of reach. I've been there myself, and I've seen it done many times, trying to repair or install something at height whilst balancing on the top rung of a ladder, hanging from the bucket of a telehandler, or narrowly balancing on a bit of 2x4 of wood crawling across roofing sheets, each time potentially moments from a catastrophic accident. I admit to being foolish enough to doing it myself a few times, often acting before thinking because the job needs done. I can recall once genuinely going to get a ladder during a storm or to fix a bit of roofing sheet on my sheep shed, which needed a new screw put in. I can remember as I went to grab the ladder thinking, what am I doing? It's 60 mile an hour winds outside and I'm about to go outside on this roof. I quickly came to my senses and left the sheet, making its own music in the wind. Now, my experiences in agriculture, I can only imagine what it must be like to industries like construction. It's a shocking statistic that 30% of workplace deaths are caused from falls by heights. And no one is immune. It's easy to imagine that this is about working at the top of the Statue of Liberty, painting the Fourth Road Bridge, or cleaning windows on the Shanghai Tower. This is just as easily about those working in shops, hospitals and factories, and indeed any occupation. I am delighted to welcome No Falls Week through the work of the No Falls Foundation, a week where we can reflect on how we can make sure we are safe at height. It is incumbent on employers to make sure that employees have the correct training and equipment. There is no excuse for employers to not make sure that staff are protected. But I want to quickly reach out to those lone workers like me, the farmers, the small business owners, the digger drivers, the tradesmen who work on their own, to say to them, your life is important, far more important than the cost of the equipment that will keep you safe whilst working at height, far more important than the roofing sheet banging in the wind, far more important than the cable which has come loose, or the bird's nest, the hydraulic hose, the loose tile, far more important. I call to them to select the right PPE, make use of a good anchor point, use the proper equipment and know how to use it, and don't skip that local training course. A day spent now might just one day save your life. My thanks to all those behind the No Fool Foundation. Their website is packed with advice, and I looked at it today over that, links and safety information. It is worth a look, no matter who you are or where you work. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Eagle. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Carol Moch in around 4 minutes, Ms Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I congratulate Claire Adamson for securing this debate, which of course is very timorous in this National Falls Week. I've entitled this speech Ladder-Related Myths, to which I will come shortly. Like the previous speaker, I observe from my own experience the different safety precautions tradesmen working on my house take. For example, every so often, in common with many, the house requires sprucing up by way of painting, not just doors, etc., but the roans and gutters. My cottage is two-storey. There's also the solid roof conservatory with its double-glazed glass roof. Previously, my regular painter, self-employed, dealt with these tasks with only ladders, and like a trapeze artist, tippy-toed across the wooden spine of the conservatory while I watched anxiously lest my very own Humpty Dumpty fell through that glass roof. Maybe he too realised retrospectively it was a bit foolhardy, or at least he was too old for the ladder routine. So next time I called him, he put me on to a colleague who insisted on scaffolding. I was relieved. It put up another £1,000 on the job, but I'd rather have that than somebody falling through the roof. So over the next 2 weeks, I was entertained as fit young men swung about the scaffolding, and I also knew that they and my glass roof would remain intact in that order of importance. In researching this, and I did research, there's a whole list of myths ladder-related, a phrase I never thought I'd use in the Parliament, ladder-related myths. Here are a few. HSE have banned the use of ladders on building sites. No, this is not the case. Ladders and step ladders can be a sensible and practical option. They can be used for work at height when the use of other work equipment is not justified because of the low risk and short duration, no more than 30 minutes at a time. Myth two, you need to be formally qualified before using a ladder at work. No, you don't. You need to be competent. This means having the necessary skills, knowledge and experience to use a ladder properly for the work you will carry out. Or if you're being trained, you work under the supervision of someone who can perform the task competently. Myth three, I'm working at height if I'm walking up and down a staircase at work. I don't give that much space. No, you're not. Work at height does not include walking up and down a permanent staircase in a building. Myth four, you need to have 2 feet and one hand on a stepladder at all times when carrying out a task. That isn't true either. When you need to have both hands free for a brief period to do a job using a stepladder, such as putting a box on a shelf, hanging wallpaper, installing a smoke detector on a ceiling, you need to maintain 3 points of contact at the working position. This is not just 2 feet and one hand, it can be 2 feet and your body. Last myth, five. HSE has banned the use of ladders to access scaffolds, and you will be fined if you ignore this ban. That isn't true either. Ladders can be used for access as long as they're of the right type, suitable grade of an industrial ladder, in good condition and effectively secured to prevent movement. So there you go, five ladder-related myths. To conclude, while I've treated the subject with a degree of a light touch, it's a very serious business, aptly described by my colleague, Claire Adamson. And this applies, the use of sensible use of ladders, as indicated by the colleague, is not only important in the workplace, but in your own home when it's you yourself using ladders. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms Graham. I see you found a new specialist subject. Now I call the final speaker in the open debate, Carol Mochan, in around 4 minutes. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Claire Adamson for bringing this important debate to the Chamber and to the two speakers before me. I enjoyed both the speeches. On behalf of Scottish Labour, can I welcome No Falls Week 2024 and restate our commitment to promoting safe working at height and reaffirming our support and solidarity to all workers injured in employment, their families and indeed to the families who have tragically lost loved ones due to workplace incidents. And that is why it is so important that we talk about these things in the Parliament. I would like to pay tribute to the No Falls Foundation organising No Falls Week, as others have said, promoting this really important piece of work. The work is critical and forms a base from which campaigns can grow and deliver results. As the motion states, across Great Britain, 40 people lost their lives in the year 2022-23 due to a fall from height. This is absolutely devastating, and I know everybody across the Chamber agrees with this. And that falls from height accounted for almost a third of all workplace deaths, just confirming how important it is that we move this forward. The workplace environment is different for everyone. Some work in more precarious and challenging conditions than others, but no matter the workplace, the safety of workers is absolutely paramount. And it's been wonderful that across this Parliament in the last few weeks we've talked about these points so much. Every worker should expect, at the very least, that their place of work is safe, that precautions are in place, and that safety features in all explanations of details around their workplace. Where this is not the case, we must redouble our efforts to ensure employers recognise the importance of employee safety and wellbeing, and that the expected standards are not only met but exceeded. Presiding Officer, this does lead me to quite an important key point as a member of the opposition, is to just raise and challenge perhaps government at times. We had a recent bill proposed, brought forward by my colleague Mark Griffin, and it was indeed an excellent bill. But just last month, this proposal was brought to the Parliament to create an Industrial Injuries Council of experts, as well as create a new employment injury benefit. And this would have been a landmark bill that would have set Scotland apart in recognising the impact of workplace injuries, including falls from height, long COVID, dementia in footballers and cancer in firefighters. So I just wanted to take the opportunity to say that the Parliament can demonstrate its dedication to the wellbeing of workers across Scotland, and that at times, you know, the opposition's role is to raise again and again what can be done by this Parliament to make a difference. But as I close, I want to say, Presiding Officer, I realise that in tonight's debate, everybody is working to make sure that we can make a difference, and I'm sure that we can do that working together. Safety at work is absolutely paramount, and I'm proud that my party stands with the trade unions and with workers in an effort to try and reduce any incidents of falls or other health and safety matters at work. And I hope that Scotland will lead the way in legislation, and that I do my part in holding the government to account on that. Thank you again to Claire Adamson for bringing the motion and to the other speakers in the debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Mochan. I now invite Tom Arthur to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by commending the No Falls Foundation on this inaugural No Falls Week, and indeed the range of partners they're working with. Can also thank members from across the Chamber for their contributions. And can I also not only thank and commend, but pay tribute to Claire Adamson for her tireless work in this area. Claire for many years has been the convener of the Cross Party Group in Accident Prevention and Safety Awareness. So for me, in my inaugural ministerial engagement in Parliament as the Minister for Employment and Investment, it's a particular privilege for me to have this opportunity to respond to Claire. And I know that another tireless champion of safety in the workplace, our late and dearly missed friend, Ron Ewing, I'm sure would be quite pleased to see this taking place. So again, want to put on record my thanks to Claire Adamson for all the work that she undertakes in this area, and also to commend the contributions from across the chamber. I think the contribution from Tim Eagle was a very powerful one, and he highlights that key point of how easy it is, just in the moment, not to be thinking, to find ourselves in precarious situations, which if we had perhaps just taking a few moments of pause to consider, we would not have allowed ourselves to think in. And that is the key point. And it is something I certainly took from reading the No Falls Foundation website myself. That key point about, you know, always challenging ourselves, training, and the importance of always making sure, this has been highlighted by other members as well as Mr Eagle, the importance of the correct and proper equipment as well. So again, I want to commend the work of the No Falls Foundation in this area. As has been highlighted, the figures really are quite striking. Across Britain, 40 lives lost due to a fall from height in 2022-23. That is 30% of all workplace deaths caused by a fall from height. And this is not just happening in the more obvious settings we might think of. Such tragic incidents occur in shops, offices and other places where the risk might not seem so apparent. On top of that, every year thousands of non-fatal falls take place, perhaps as many as 100 every day. That has an economic impact as well. In 2022-23, up to 992,000 working days were lost through non-fatal falls from height, and the estimated total cost was over £847 million. The number of lives lost and affected by falls from height at work are disturbing enough. But the statistics are made more impactful when we remember that behind them are the lives of individual people, their families, friends and colleagues. And that is the one thing I want to commend the No Falls Foundation on. It's work to highlight real-life accounts and provide insight into the consequences in people's lives. Today in this chamber, we recognise the work of the No Falls Foundation to prevent accidents in the workplace through increasing awareness and understanding, and to support those whose lives have been affected. And I want to add my own voice in encouraging employers to access the Foundation's resources hub and consider how they might be able to participate this week, and also what action they can take to promote the well-being of their employees. Presiding Officer, health and safety at work is certainly...
Christine Graham.
I think one of the issues is, in fact, the self-employed. It's different. You've got an employer. An employer has a duty of care, so he can have a he or she can have a liability, or the company can have a liability. But the issue, I think, is when you have self-employed who maybe are trying to cut the costs and understand that, and taking on jobs, and like my man and his ladder, you know, maybe saying, well, I'll do it because the scaffolding will put another big bill on it. So how do you get through to the self-employed who may also not be reporting what happens to them?
Minister.
I think that's an incredibly important point, and I think it's incumbent on all of us working in partnership to promote best practice, and clearly organisations such as No Falls Foundation, along with business representative organisations and trade unions, Scottish Hazard and others, can all help to create an environment where that information is readily available and to promote best practice, especially for those who are self-employed or operating in small and micro businesses. Presiding Officer, health and safety at work is, of course, important to all of us. Good working environments are key to good health, which is important for people accessing and staying in work. And safe workplaces contribute to good mental health. Safe and healthy working conditions are also an internationally recognised human right. However, it is important to point out that health and safety is a reserved matter and not something that this Parliament or this Government has direct control over. The Health and Safety Executive is responsible for enforcement across the UK, including in Scotland. However, we do have representation on the Partnership on Health and Safety in Scotland, which brings together key players in workplace health and safety in Scotland, and we are taking action through the powers we do have. Our Fair Work approach recognises the importance of safe workplaces that support people's health and well-being, and fully supports our commitments to embed equality, inclusion and human rights in everything we do. I welcome the contribution of the many employers in Scotland who are already implementing Fair Work practices. Between 2019 and 2023, Fair Work First was applied to approximately £4 billion worth of public sector funding, contracts and grants. In July last year, we went further and strengthened Fair Work conditionality in public sector grants and now require employers in receipt of grants to pay at least the real living wage and provide appropriate channels for effective workers' voice. An effective voice is one of the critical elements of Fair Work, providing channels for workers to innovate, raise concerns and be involved in decisions about how their workplace operates. There are many forms that effective voice can take. However, the involvement of workers themselves is key in underpinning safe and healthy workplaces. It is our long-standing position that a progressive approach to industrial relations, along with stronger protection for workers, is at the heart of a fairer, more successful society. Trade unions can and do make a strong contribution to supporting health and safety and identifying and managing risk. A crucial element of our support for safe and healthy workplaces are the services delivered by Healthy Working Lives, SALIS and Working Health Services Scotland. We support and advise employers with a particular focus on small and medium-sized enterprises that do not have access to in-house occupational health services. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I do want to recognise again the importance of this issue and to commend the work of the No Falls Foundation and its partners. It is an example of how critical safe, healthy and fair workplaces are to workers, employers and indeed to Scotland's economy as a whole.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes this debate and I close this meeting of Parliament.